Dear friends, welcome to this question-answer series presented by Dr. Johnson C. Philip. Dr. Philip has spent his whole life answering young and old on an unbelievably wide range of subjects. His ultimate aim is to help you to find answers to your questions and even doubts. In turn, this will help you in multiple ways. Dr. Philip keeps posting question answers regularly. Many of these can be very helpful to you. Do not miss any of them. Please subscribe to our channel and you will get notice of each and every video as it is posted. It is easy to subscribe. Below this video you will see a subscribe icon. Please click it. Please also click the bell icon there to confirm your subscription. That is all. You will never miss any of these life-transforming videos. God bless you.
Hello. Good evening. Thanks for logging into this program. I hope to record a very long series of question answers to handle those questions which a lot of Christians ask and for which often no easy answers are there. Once you view this video, please look into the comment box, the first comment box of this video, and in that comment box I will list the links to all the question answer programs that are available. That way you will be able to see the rest of the program or rest of question answers, or you can choose whichever you want to see. Today the question is, there is a person, he was reading a book or he was watching some video program. As he was watching it or as he was reading the book, because of some statement in the book or because of some statement in that video, he decided to accept Lord Jesus as his savior. So on the spot, he accepts Lord Jesus as his savior. Doesn't know much of theology, doesn't know much about anything in the Bible, but one thing is very sure, that the moment he read that book, a certain passage in that book, or the moment he heard that video, he realized that only Lord Jesus is Savior, and that on that spot he accepted Lord Jesus as his Savior. Now, once he did that, once he does that, he realizes that he needs to tell this to others, other Christians or other followers of Lord Jesus. Maybe he is even a member of a church, so he goes to the church and tells his friends, tells his uncles, tells his aunts, probably tells his siblings and parents that, listen, I was reading the following book. I was reading the following passage from the Bible, or I was watching such and such video, and suddenly I realized that I have to accept Lord Jesus as my Savior. And on the spot, I accepted Lord Jesus as my Savior. And since that moment, I have an assurance of salvation. I am a child of God. What to do? Is he genuinely saved? Or did he have to go through a lot of steps that many people prescribe? For example, you need to repent first, and then you need to accept Lord Jesus in your heart as your Lord and Savior, and then you have to confess with your mouth that he is your Savior. Then only you will be saved. There are many people who take this stand. Is that a biblical stand? And if that is a biblical stand, is this boy, it can also be a girl, or is this girl saved? Before we look at the Bible, there is a story that I want to tell you, because that story furnishes the background to understand this claim that you have to pass through half a dozen steps before you are saved, And if you don't have those half a dozen steps in your life, then you're not saved. I live in a state in India known as Kerala. Kerala is a unique state. In other states, once you leave a village, you may have to travel 10 or even 20 kilometers before the next village comes. Kerala as a whole is a single village because as you move, maybe half a kilometer, the next village comes. And there is no boundary. All what you see is a board that says this and this village. And then you realize that you left a village and you have come to a second one. So, and it's the same throughout Kerala. That being the situation, buses, transport buses, when they go from one place to another, say 30 kilometers, at every 1,000 feet, you may have a bus stand and people simply waiting to climb into the bus. This is not seen in states outside Kerala. Now, in Kerala, there are two kinds of buses. It's the same with all states, but Kerala has something very surprising. One, private buses. They stop everywhere. They pick up each and every person who wants to get into the bus. And even if there is heavy rush inside the bus, they still stop and accommodate as many people as they can accommodate. Then there are government buses. In government buses are driven by drivers whose salary is guaranteed, very high salary, guaranteed salary, whether you pick up travelers or not, your salary is guaranteed. In private buses, you have to make a certain amount of income to assure your monthly salary. In government buses, income is guaranteed. Your salary is guaranteed. Driver, salary is guaranteed. Conductor, salary is guaranteed. Even if you don't have a single traveler in a whole month, or if you have only one passenger per day, you get your salary. Now, in those buses, there is a very high tendency for the driver and conductor to ignore travelers standing on the road. And people who travel in these buses, they know this psychology. And people who travel, everybody wants comfort. So once a bus, I mean government bus, is reasonably full, many of the passengers request the conductor not to stop the bus anyway. They know that the driver and conductor consider passengers as a nuisance. Their salary is guaranteed. And all what they have to do is show that a few passengers traveled. Knowing their psychology, many travelers do one thing. When the bus is reasonably full, they request the conductor to ring the bell twice. Ringing once means stop. Ringing twice means go. And while the bus is running, if the conductor rings twice, that means driver, do not stop the vehicle anywhere. So many of these passengers request the conductor, sir, please ring the bell twice. And many times conductors oblige. What these travelers want is, now that they are inside the bus, they do not want others to come in and travel. As long as they were outside, they wanted to get into the bus. But once they got into the bus, they do not want others to come. This is a universal human behavior. Though I narrated the story from Kerala, the state where I live, actually, this is a universal tendency. People want privileges. every privilege that humans can offer them, every privilege that God can offer them. But once they get the privilege, they want to block the same privilege, the same door, the same opening to others. If you look at the theology, Christian theology of last 2000 years, we see the same tendency everywhere. Sinners, they come to God, they enjoy all kind of grace, but then they do not want others to enjoy the same grace, same privilege. That was the problem in Galatia. That was the problem in Corinth. That was the problem in Colossae. That was the problem in Thessalonica. And that has come as a big problem in the 20th century. Actually, I should say, it has come as a big problem in the last three centuries, because communication of ideas has become easier in the last 3 to 5 centuries with the invention of printing press, the moving type printing press. Printing ideas and spreading them has become easy. And therefore, many, many people who have this attitude, I am here by God's grace, but nobody else should get this privilege, they have developed all kinds of ideas, and they spread these ideas to claim that no, you cannot enter easily into God's presence. It is they who spread these ideas that salvation is a multi-step process. First of all, you need to repent. Then you have to ask for forgiveness. Then you have to accept Lord Jesus as your personal Savior. And then with your mouth, you have to confess. I mentioned only 4 steps. There are some people who list up to 7 steps for a person to be saved. Please remember, it is not these men who are our guides. Unfortunately, because of heavy spread of media, people who teach error, they have been able to spread their error because they do it with much zeal. Those who know the truth and those who teach the truth, they just remain silent. Ha-ha, so-so, chalta hai, chalne do. We are not zealous. Our zeal is not sufficient. But those who teach error, they are very zealous. They teach with zeal and they spread their ideas with zeal and they use print media, and these days they are also using the electronic media, which are very effective and also practically zero cost. And I have heard people listing as many as 7 steps for salvation. Please remember, we do not decide truth or falsehood on the basis of what humans teach. He may be a scholar, he may be highly respected, but even the voice or the opinion of even the most respected or learned person is not the foundation on which we establish Bible doctrines. Bible doctrines are established on the basis of what the Bible says. That is what we see in Berea. The believers in Berea were highly commended by the Holy Spirit himself because they, after they heard men preaching, they examined in the scriptures whether these things are so. And therefore, in this matter, should be, is salvation a 2-step process, 5-step or 7-step? Let us look into the word of God. We know about the Philippian jailer. When he heard that, when he saw that doors are open, he tried to kill himself. The apostle said, don't harm yourself. We have not run away. We are here. And his first question was, he understood everything, that this is God's work. And his question was, gentlemen, sirs, what should I do for salvation? And please remember, the reply came from one of the apostles, a person who lived close close to God, who was inspired directly by the Holy Spirit. And his answer was, believe on the Lord Jesus and you will be saved and your family, which means the jailer and any member of his family who was in a position to believe. Infants are not in a position to believe. Anyone who was in a position to believe, if he or she believed, they would have salvation. No conditions, no stipulations, no multi-steps, no multiple steps. This is the plain word of God. Believe on Lord Jesus and you will be saved. And therefore, in the light of the scripture, this young man or woman who, whatever the circumstances might be, if he or she accepted Lord Jesus as his or her Savior, he is saved. That is what the scripture says. Now, the scripture very clearly says that God invites everyone. It is man who tries to block it. He behaved like those passengers who were full of complaint that driver doesn't stop the bus. But once he stopped, or drivers don't stop the bus. But once they got a bus, stopped in their place, once they got in, they do not want others to enter. Brothers and sisters, that attitude has been ruling the Christian world for the last 300 years, because those who teach this error, they spread their error with zeal. They write, they preach, they spread. That's how this erroneous idea has spread. The scripture places only one condition. Believe on the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. Or you may say, in some places repentance is mentioned. Yes, but do you know that in New Testament repentance is used often as a synonym for belief? We will handle that subject in some other question answer session. But please remember, scripture places only one condition: believe and you will be saved. Let me remind you, the thief who was with Lord Jesus, he believed. Ruth, the Gentile lady, she only said, your God will be my God. She was saved. Rahab, she only said, your God has given them into your hands, which expressed her belief. She was saved. Ruth and Rahab became members in the genealogy of Lord Jesus Christ. Lot of others are there. Please remember, lot of others are there. They believed, and it was counted unto them for righteousness. That's again a quote from the word of God. Believe, and it will be counted unto you as righteousness. Romans chapter 5 says, having been justified by faith, not through seven steps, having been justified by faith. And therefore, if there is a young man or a young woman or a not so young person who claims that they accepted Lord Jesus as their personal Savior and they have assurance, then they are saved. Don't impose man-made steps upon them. Let us not behave like people in Galatia, the Judaizers in Galatia. They had to be told one thing, and particularly Peter, who joined the Judaizers. You are a Jew. You are behaving like a Gentile. What right, what moral right do you have to ask the Gentiles to behave like a Jew? Please remember, brothers and sisters, God has opened the way. Believe on the Lord Jesus, you will be saved. Let us not close that door. God bless you. We will come with a lot many more questions and answers. Look into the comment box to see links of other videos. God bless you.
Dear friends, I am confident that you enjoyed listening to this question answer video by Dr. Johnson C. Philip. He would love to get your questions. Please post your questions in the comment box below this video and he will prepare a video reply for you. Please post only one question at a time, and make it as detailed as possible so that Dr. Philip has no problem in understanding exactly what you mean. Also, please encourage this ministry by subscribing to this channel. Below this video, there is a subscribe button. please click it. Also, please click the bell icon near it to complete the process of subscribing. Thank you very much for being such an encouragement to our channel.